Okay. So, an outline of my talk, I will say a few words about an introduction for the subject about polyploids. Then we will spend some time in discussing about it, how to genotype and how to make the SNP calling in autopolyploids is different from diploids. So something that we have been working on the last years. Then we go to the genetic linkage map. That is also something that has keeping us very busy the last years because this is a very complicated issue. And then final considerations about the research subject. I'm pretty sure all of you know what is a genetic linkage map. It started with this classical paper by Stutter from more than 100 years ago. This is the first genetic published map using Drosophila. Of course, now they have more loci involving, you know, genes and markers and all those things. We are used to see genetic linkage maps like this one is a passion fruit, sweet passion fruit map published on this Annals of Applied Biology. You can see you have much more information to build the maps because you have markers, you have more markers, you can have information about linkage phase and a number of things. Of course, it's much well saturated than the first maps, but the principles are pretty much the same. And maps are important because we can use the map for a number of applications, including, for example, with studies of synteny between different species. Of course, you can compare the genome, but you don't have the genome sequence for a number of species, so a map could be, and used for different purposes, you can compare maps to study the synteny between species. You can also use a map to study, for example, patterns of recombination, evolutionary studies. You can use a map to locate the QTL, loci influencing the variation in a quantitative trait. You can use a map to do map-based studies and cloning. And of course, you can use a map to refine the novel assembling. So the map is useful for genomic studies as well, and then for basic stuff and also applied studies. So that's why we are trying to do linkage map for autopolyploids. When we think about the diploids that are more common in most of the publications, we are talking about species that have two sets of chromosomes, like this one here representing the maize. It could be maize or other species. When you have 10 pairs of homologous chromosomes with two sets of each chromosome. When we say genotyping a diploid, we are saying about accessing the variation between those two homologous chromosomes. For example, we are looking for a variation that can differentiate this chromosome from this one, or a polymorphism in this chromosome that is different from the polymorphism in the other chromosome. We use molecular markers most of the time to do this because they are more abundant in the genome, they are well distributed, and then we can use this to measure this variation. And based on this one, we can build the map and then use the map for the other purposes, as I said before. But now comes to the situation. Species like sugarcane and other autopolyploid species. This is a very famous representation about the genome of sugarcane. This is a representation about how the sugarcane genome is, where the situation is much, much more complicated. Of course, we can have autotetraploid species that have four sets of chromosomes. It's like this one, but with four homologous chromosomes. We have species with six chromosomes, like sweet potato. And then we have species like sugarcane that we have more than six homologous chromosomes for each homology group. And actually, this number is not fixed for the homology group. For example, we can have an homology group with more than 10 homologous chromosomes and other ones which have less chromosomes. So the ploid level is not fixed within the species, which makes the situation much, much more complicated. If you genotype a SNP and you don't know, if you don't have the genome, we don't have the genome of sugarcane, we don't know where the SNP is and we don't know the ploid level, which is the ploid level which this SNP is associated. So this makes things even difficult than we have on the diploids because we need somehow to infer the ploid level of where the SNP is located to use this information for doing something useful. How can we use molecular markers in such a complex genome? It's not a trivial task. It's not as just adapting protocols for diploids and then assessing the variation because the problem is much more complex, much more complicated. For example, let's say that we have a species that has eight homologous chromosomes. This could be the case for sugarcane, for example. Could be this one, or, you know, I'm not counting here, but could be any of the group where we have 8 copies of the homologous chromosomes. What we can have, if we use a biallelic marker, like SNPs, we can have up to P plus 1 possible genotypes. We can have information from 0, we have a variation from 0 to 8 copies of a given allele. So heterozygous will be a mixture of different dosages of each allele. It's not like in diploids where you have homozygous or heterozygous. When you say heterozygous in a diploid, you say big A, small a. When you say heterozygous for a polyploid, you need to go to details, because you can have all this range of variation. We can have from 1 to 7 copies. These are all heterozygous. We need somehow to infer this one, because this information cannot be just hidden or ignored, because, of course, for a polyploid, this should be important if you are trying to assess the genomic variation, or if you are trying to connect the variation in the markers with the phenotype. We need to think about the dosage, because dosage is something that is common in polyploids. If you use markers like microsatellites for complex polyploids, you cannot access this range of variation. Up to autotetraploids, I think you can, in some situations, infer the dosage using even microsatellites. But for sugarcane, you cannot. It's impossible, because the system will not work as expected. And as a consequence, you're going to have only presence or absence of markers. So, of course, we need to access those, because the most intuitive models, or at least the first models we're going to thinking about associating markers with phenotypes, would be modeling the dosage of markers. We need to know if we have more copies of in a given allele, if you have an improvement or decreasing in a given phenotype. So that's why this information is important. We started working with sugarcane a long time ago. In the beginning, the only marker we had, it was microsatellites, but then we proposed a research project that was finished in 2014, where we are trying to develop protocols for genotyping a complex polyploid, such as sugarcane, and more than that, analyzing the data afterwards, because, of course, the data is different from the diploid scenario. And also, we want to prove that it is possible to genotype a complex genome such as this one. So back then, we proposed it using a max spectrometry for doing the genotyping, max spectrometry, because this is back in like the 10 years ago, 8 years ago. And then that was the technology that seems to be promising for doing the genotyping back then. But now we can work with any modern technology, just a proof of concept. If it works with a mass spectrometry, it will work with fluorescence or GBS or SNP chip or any technology you have. And I'm going to show you how. The idea is we needed to genotype this one, and we needed to be able to access the dosage, because the dosage is important in principle for a polyploid. We needed to at least check if this assumption that dosage can have an influence on some quantitative trait. We need to have a technique to genotype that allows us to assess this dosage. Okay. A few details about this one. When you genotype using a quantitative method like mass spectrometry or GBS, that's quite common these days, what you have is the relative abundance of the two alleles in your individual. For example, I'm looking here for a C and a G. As you can see, we have a strong peak here only for G, and we don't have a signal here for C. This is a mass spectrometer, but this applies for GBS. It would be only the number of reads that have the G and the number of reads that has the C. In this case, all of them are G. This individual is an homozygous for a G, right? It doesn't have a C. And then if we put this in a graph, we're going to have like a peak here should be, for example, the mass of this allele. Okay, you see? Another individual, for example, we can have an individual that has a peak here for G and another peak here for C. This is an heterozygous, right? Because it has G and C, and some more copies of G than C, because you can see that this peak is higher for this one. So if you plot in a two-dimensional graph, we're going to have this point somehow in the graph here with a ratio more to G than to C, right? And it's different from diploids, because for diploids you can be, they will be pretty much, the peaks will be pretty much the same if nothing goes wrong. The peak would be approximately the same, so we're gonna have a 45 degrees angle here, because the peaks will be approximately the same idea, because we're gonna have A and little big A and little a in the same ratio. But for polyploids, this is different. If you know the ploid level, you know how much clusters you are expecting, how many slopes you are expecting, because you know all possible ratios. For example, for an octaploid, you are going to expect from 0 to 80 copies, and you're going to have here the correspondent for all these proportions. But if you don't know the ploid level, which should be the case for sugarcane, because we don't know where this dip is on the genome, we need somehow to infer the ploid level. That would make things even more complicated than the usual. We're not talking about looking for, we don't have expectation about the number of things we have here. So what we did, before I say what we did, I'm gonna show some data here. For example, this is our real data for three sugarcane SNPs. Here, it seems easy to see that we have like three clusters here, and then we can estimate the slopes of the curves and can somehow infer the ploid level. This is also real data. We also can see three, but if you look further, we actually don't know if this is a cluster or not, or if these two points are a cluster or not. If this is in a experimental population, and we have, for example, a Mendelian F1 Mendelian crossing, we have categories expecting less individuals than this one. We cannot just say that this is an outlier, because this could not be true, because we have an expectation of a distribution of different genotypes. Some of them are more common, some of them are rare. So we cannot just drop this data. And of course, we can have a lot of noise. This is very hard to infer something right here. The problem is that the number of clusters is function of the ploid and dosage that are unknown. What we did? First, back in 2012, we developed, this is a collaboration. Oliver was a visiting scientist in my lab. Marcelo Molinari was a PhD student back then. And then we worked together on this one to develop a statistical method to classify the data for genotyping polyploids, especially when you don't know the ploid level. The basic idea is that we have this probabilistic graphical model where we're making connections between information and expectations that we have for our data set. The ploid level is something that is influential everything here in this model, because depending on the ploid level, the higher the ploid level, the higher the number of clusters you expect, and then the slopes you expected on that graph. Also, the ploid levels will determine, for example, the genotypes of individuals. If you have a tetraploid, you are expecting from 0 to 4 copies of a given allele. For this one, you have data. Data is something that came from the technology, of course. The machine will give you the ratio between the peaks. That's pretty much the data you have. We also can have data on the parents, if this is an experimental population, we're going to have in a parents. And if we have parents, we have a theoretical distribution. For example, let's say we have a parent that is a single dosage, one copy of one allele, all the others from the other. Another parent that is also single dosage, one copy of one allele, all the copies from the other. The theoretical distribution will be a segregation 1-to-1, because it will behave like single dose segregation to 1-to-1, Mendelian segregation. If this is different, things will be more complicated, but in essence, this is what this model is about. What else? We also have the observed distribution, right? Because once you classify the data, you can build the histograms, and then you can have the, once you assume some ploid level, you can classify your data and see how the data will behave. Building histograms of the genotypes once you classify them. The problem here is to find the maximum a posteriori solution, that is the configuration set of assignments that maximizes the joint probability of the network given the data. In other words, what is the combination of the ploid level, the genotype of the parent, the theoretical distribution, the observing the distribution, the data from the machine? What is the configuration between all those parameters and things that give me the maximum posteriori solution? By doing this one, we can, for example, see, this is the data I showed before, classify this SNP as being a SNP that is in the decaploid part of the sugarcane genome. We infer deployed leverage is 10, and then we classify the individuals in these clusters. These individuals are located here. We have the probability of being correctly classified, because we, for example, this green one, we don't know if it's from here or here, but and then we attach it a small probability of being right when we say that the genotype is a given genotype. This one, as I mentioned before, is connected with the theoretical distribution. This is important because if this is an F1 population, we have a expected distribution. This could be an association mapping panel. We can assume Hardy-Weinberg for a given population. Well, you can put any expectation you have about the segregation. So the model is general enough to work on any population that you have crosses. And then we can estimate the deployed. For this SNP, deployed is very likely to be 10, okay? By doing this, we are able to, in 2013, to publish in a paper saying that we can genotype a complex polyploid such as sugarcane and other complex, and then we can have valid discussions. Because remember when I started, back then, when we started this project, many people were very skeptical about we being able to genotype a complex polyploid such as sugarcane and have reliable data. If you go back some years, the technology was not there and the methods was not there yet to analyze this data. So this was something that was necessary to do. What we can say about the sugarcane genome? Well, sugarcane is a complex polyploid, as I mentioned before. The sugarcane ploid for these genotypes we studied ranges from 6 to 14, you see. That's what we find. And also an important discussion that for sugarcane people is relevant is that single dosage markers with a single copy is not the majority of the genome. If you talk to sugarcane people, they will say that this is are the most important markers, but our data is not in agreement with this affirmation. I think that there is an overestimation in the literature about the number of SNPs in single dosage. That's just pretty much because of the method they use to say that the SNP is in single dosage. Okay. So let's now come back to the present. This is useful, but now we have a more modern data. And then Gabriel Margarido, that is a colleague in my department, working on this paper together with Guilherme Pereira, to develop a pipeline for, you know, making to automatize the tasks that are involved in genotyping a polyploid and making the SNP callings. You receive data from your technology machine, you want to run Supermassa. The software is named Supermassa. This is a trick because in English it looks like because it was based on max spectrometry, but in Portuguese Supermassa means pretty cool. It's something really cool, so this is a trick. In English it doesn't make sense, but in Portuguese it's something. If you say for a Brazilian Supermassa, he will understand, you're gonna say this is cool, you know? And this pipeline, which name is VCF to Supermassa, is under evaluation on BNC Bioinformatics. It's pretty much Gabriel's and Guilherme work. We applied this for data that we found online or data that we know to see if this pipeline could be useful for classifying the data. And then the results are reliable, show that the results are reliable. There is also something new. In 2018, we have another publication for genotyping polyploids from mass sequence data. Now we are thinking about the data that we have in 2018. This is developed by Luiz Felipe Ferran. He was a PhD student in my lab. He stayed during his sandwich PhD with Matthew Stephens, and then he knew David Gerard. That he was working with Matthew Stevens during that time. And then he presented the problem and some of his ideas about problems that we have given the experience we acquired over the years for genotyping a polyploid. And then all this come up in a publication that will be on the November issue of Genetics. So actually it is online if you want to see. Online first is already available about this paper. We are including here aspects that we ignore in the Supermassa. The problem was complicated enough. Of course, we knew that this could happen, but there were so many things to think when we were working with Supermassa that we just needed to ignore that one in a first approach. Now we can add more things that we know are common. For example, we have a sequencing error in our data, we can have allelic bias, we can have overdispersion, and we can have outliers. Even if we consider the theoretical distribution, this is, should be present in any sample, right? So this is, of course, I don't want you to understand, it's hard even for me when I read this one because there are many notations and details, but the idea is that the model is building up the things that, the bias that we can have or the complications that can arise for us in this technology. If we start from a very simple thing that we wanted to estimate, that it is the proportion of one allele over the others, so A divided by A, big A plus small a, is this the ratio of a big A, right? For a single observation, if you have multiple observations, that you have one for each chromosome, you're going to have a Bernoulli with the parameter B. No, Bernoulli is for a single SNP. Actually, when we add up for all the SNPs, one on each chromosome, you're going to have a binomial with parameters N and P. And then, from here, you can construct, for example, assuming that you can have an error when you are inferring the proportion of the ratio between the two SNPs, right? We put here like error, epsilon. We can have not having an error, this would be correct, but we put another parameter here to say, from time to time, you think you are going to see a proportion, but actually you are not. It's just because the technology has this problem. Also, we can have bias. Bias is by saying that the technology is not perfect. So you expect an angle to be like this one, and for some reason, the PCR doesn't work right, the technology doesn't work right, and then you have a bias on the angle. It's not because you're changing the proportion, but just because the data is like putting an allelic bias. Some of the alleles have a preferential reading. We can model this like this one. We can also have overdispersion, and then we can also have outliers. I don't expect you to understand these things, but just to give an intuition about these things, we have here three SNPs that I can illustrate the situation. The first one here has overdispersion. Looks like overdispersion because you see the points around the line here are kind of having different dispersion for any of the lines. In the second one is a classical case of bias. You see, it looks like we can think about a cluster here and another one here, but they are more on the vertical axis because the technology didn't work the way we are expecting, so we should put this in the model. In the third, we have an observation that is pretty much a candidate to be an outlier, right? Out of the scope of the data. If we use the package named UPDOC, it was not my idea to give this fancy name. Supermassive was not my idea as well, just people suggesting I accepted that one. The thing is, we were able to make this classification using this new approach with UPDOC that Supermassa was not able to do. See like this one. For Supermassa, this data with an outlier, Supermassa will say that this data belongs to a cluster. I think this is a different color because we can have this data based on the theoretical distribution. Using UPDOC that models outliers, you're gonna say, well, this is pretty much an outlier, you can just drop the data without any problem because this fits the data better, we have reasons to decide that one. If you use a Supermassa for data with bias, you're classified this data in two clusters, the black one and the yellow one, you're gonna see you put some black dots here, some dots here as black because you need to accommodate for the proportions you are expecting with a distribution of two clusters. If we have the bias, we think that using UPDOC we can split this in two categories because what we are seeing here is just, we have just a different angles here, not based on the dosage, but on different issues. For overdispersion, the thing is pretty much the same. Okay, so now we move from the first part of my talk. When I said, I think we can now at least have some reliable data about genotype. We still have problems, we still need to learn a lot. When we start using UPDOC for a number of things, you're gonna learn a lot, and then thinking about the next step, you know, over the years, this is something we are expecting actually. But we think that now we can at least start the conversation. You can genotype, you can use any modern protocol, you can have the SNP calling, so you have data that you somehow believe are correct to start your analysis. So now we can think about using this data for building a linkage map. Again, comparing diploids with autopolyploids. For diploids, we have pretty much everything. Christiane mentioned one map that is a package that was developed in my lab that builds linkage, that an R package that builds linkage map for pretty much any diploid population you have of plant species. For experimental crosses, you can build your map for anything, including outcrossing, where you need to estimate linkage phase. But for autopolyploids, we have something. I think I missed something here. Sorry if I don't include relevant paper here. But we have methods for auto-hexaploids, recently auto-hexaploids to building linkage map. But you see, sugarcane is not auto-hexaploid. Sugarcane is a mixture of things and have high diploid levels. So we need to deal with this if we want to someday have a good sugarcane linkage map. So we started doing this many years ago. Marcelo Molinari was the guy in charge of this. It was his PhD thesis, working on a method, and he's working with Xiaobang Zeng now in North Carolina. He's still working on methods for linkage mapping in polyploids. But let's see how complicated the problem is and the solution that we provided. Let's assume you are making a biparental cross between two auto-hexaploid individuals. We have here two loci, right, K and K plus one, just to represent two loci. And every loci can have up to six different alleles if you think in a fully informative system where you can detect the difference between everything that are around the chromosomes. Of course, this should be, if you have the same copy, to be a particular case where you have individuals in these things. Just about to start, meiosis on these things, you need to say, well, how is the meiosis on something like this so I can measure recombination? Because for building a map, we need to count the number of recombinant individuals. We can have for bivalent pairing, we can have different configurations because six chromosomes, if we have bivalents during meiosis, we can have different arrangements. For example, this one will pair with this one with this one, and the two green ones here. For a hexaploid, we have 15 possible bivalent configurations. In general, this is the formula, the number of configurations. And then, for auto-octa, you put 8 here, M is the ploid level, you're going to have much more bivalent configurations for 10 and so on. Remember that sugarcane went from 6 to 14, is a big number. For each of these bivalents, we can have recombination as we do for traditional Mendelian analysis. This is the transition matrix where we have the recombinants and non-recombinants. But since we have three bivalents here for an auto-hexaploid, we can just do a Kronecker product here. And then by doing this, we have this general formula that tells you the configuration, the probability of having one configuration in one loci and the configuration in the other loci given the configuration in the previous. No? So you have this formula that is general. We don't need to see the matrix because we just have the formula to know each element on this matrix. Once we have this one, we need to take into consideration that we can have different bivalent configurations. This formula will work for all possible bivalent configurations, but for some bivalent configurations, we cannot have a recombinant or a parental because it's not possible to have this configuration because the chromosomes are not pairing on that bivalent configurations. To summarize these things, this formula is putting everything together, giving the configuration, and we need to sum up all the configurations, the possible configurations. As you can see, more formulas, more complications, but in theory, this formula was developed, and this formula can put all possible bivalent configurations together and give us a probability of observing a haplotype with a given configuration for the two adjacent loci. This is the formula. Also, we don't need to see the elements, we can calculate them when we need them, because of course we are doing something that is algebraically complex, not complex, but you know, tedious to do. Once we have this one, if we convert this joint probability to a conditional probability, we have the transition probability to building the map using the traditional approach that is using a hidden Markov chain. I know the genotype in one marker. What's the probability of having a genotype in the following one, given that I know this one? To have a recombinant, I need to have a recombination. To have the same, I need to have the same genotype that I have in the parents, I need to have no recombination, so this formula is doing this transition, the transition probabilities. Given this one, we can go to a very tedious process of running this in a hidden Markov model, putting all these things together, I will skip this one, and say that we can, well, use all the information to build the linkage map, considering that I can have different bivalent pairing, and also that I needed to estimate the linkage phase, because we don't know the linkage phase, because sugarcane and most of the autopolyploids are also outcrossing species. So I needed to estimate the linkage phase between the markers. Okay, so what's the outcome? If you run this this model, this very sophisticated model, but very informative model, you're going to have this outcome. So what I mean by the outcome? If you run this method using the data that you collect for markers, you use this transition probability in a hidden Markov model, you are going to estimate this map. This is a map for an auto-octaploid species. Every rectangle here is a marker. And I have white and black rectangles to show in the two, I'm saying SNPs because be allelic, right? Just summarizing the situation, because we're going to use SNPs that are the state of the art in markers now. So we're genotyping for SNPs, we're going to have a black and white. This one is a SNP that is in triple dosage, right? You see three copies of black and one, two, three, four, five. I cannot adapt three to five to see that is eight, but it's three and five to give eight. Triple dosage. This marker is has four copies. This one, three. This one is a single dosage marker. This one is a single dosage. Another one, single dosage. So that's, I think you got the idea. These markers are linked. The distance between them, I needed to estimate. In this representation that I have here, I'm just saying I can estimate the distance, but in this scenario here, I'm just showing a representation of equally spaced markers, which of course is not true in the real scenario, but just to show you how would be the outcome of the analysis. If this individual is crossed with this one, with another configuration, you can see that you don't have a polymorphism here, but you can infer this distance based on information from the markers in the other parent, right? We can estimate the distance between markers, also the linkage phase between them. So by linkage phase, I see this is the representing a chromosome, homologous chromosome. This is representing another homologous chromosome. This is representing another homologous chromosome, and so on, up to eight, because we have eight different ones. Does it work? We made simulations to prove this one. So this is the result of three scenarios for three different ploid levels, and each of them with five different configurations. For example, let me explain this in detail. Let me take an auto-tetraploid species. This would be parent P and parent Q. So here I have the configuration of the markers in one parent, and here I have the configuration of the markers in the other parent. They are pretty much in association, right? Because black is linked with black and white is linked with white, with a few exceptions. And I want to build a map for this cross. So assuming that I have this parent, how would be the progeny? And I'll collect data in the progeny, making the SNP calling and analyzing the data to build the map. This is one scenario. Another one would be this, the second one. So here, on this cell, I have one, two, three, four, five different scenarios. But most of the markers are in association. The SNP, the black SNPs are linked with the black ones and the white with the white ones. Scenario B, five different scenarios, I name it B, we name it B, where the linkage is somehow mixed here. So we have black with white sometimes, is intermediate between the case C, scenario C, where we have this pretty much random, much more complicated, well, because we wanted to infer the linkage phase. I think you got the idea, right? Auto-hexaploid, auto, autotetra, autohexa, and auto-octaploid. So three different ploid levels and different configuration. A, the easier one, B, intermediate, C, the most complicated one, and different assumptions. For each of these crosses, we made 1,000 samples, Monte Carlo samples. We generated 1,000 maps and reconstructed the map using the method I mentioned before to see what happened. Okay, do you understand? A number of scenarios for simulations, 1,000 of each one, 1,000 here, 1,000 here, and so on. What happened? This is the results. For example, this is for the cross, the first cross between P and Q, auto tetraploid, ploid level 4, and then the first scenario, exactly this one. We made this cross 1,000 times, build 1,000 maps, and try to recover the information about the linkage phase. What happened? We are able to estimate the linkage phase with being correct 100% of the time. So for the 1,000 simulations, we all of them are correct. As you can see, the eight situation, eight cases, we are able to estimate the linkage phase for pretty much all configurations because somehow easy, okay? But you see, for auto-hexaploid and auto-octaploid, this the number of possible situations and transitions that you can have is very complicated, but even with all these complications, the result were like, we are able to estimate the linkage phase correct for all simulations. For situation B, numbers are pretty high here, right? You see not more than 95 or 94. I think the smallest one is like 94, maybe something. It's a very good result, I think. For the C, you have some case, for example, here, 88%. But remember, 88 for an auto-octaploid, in this particular situation where we want to build this map, you see, you want to reconstruct the genotypes of the parents of the cross you made, and they are, you know, somehow complicated. We don't know which one is the real one because there is no map to compare the results. But for simulations, the result worked pretty well, I think. What else? Also, the distance. How is the estimate of the distance? This is hard to see here, but I have the distribution of the average distance comparing the real map with the simulated one. For example, I have a map here with a given size, with a given distance between the markers, and then I have my map where I have the estimated distance of the markers in the map. We can compute the Euclidean distance between those markers, and the smaller the distance between those markers, the more closer they are. And as you can see here, the values for most of the simulations are very, very close. The distance is no higher than, I cannot see details here, but I think it's not higher than 2 centimorgans for the Euclidean distance. It's not easy to interpret this one when I'm say here in front of you, but if you think about comparing two maps, it's more likely to say if the distances are similar for each interval. So I think we should submit the paper for considering this method, and then this is the paper that is under submission. I can see is from 2017 plus one. I think we're going to withdraw the paper because they're not giving us a reply. Of course, I'm very angry with the editor because he's just saying, well, we cannot find anyone to see the paper. But the thing is, we got a round of major requesting major revisions. We replied to that one and never got a final answer to say if they will say yes or no. This is very disappointing. But anyway, the paper is under evaluation, showing the results of this mapping for complex autopolyploid species. If you are thinking about autotetraploid that you have a number of methods, this method is equivalent of any method that uses a hidden Markov model. For autohexaploid, is the same. If you are using a hidden Markov model, it's this one. But the notation and the ideas that we developed are general enough to say that this is just you can just plug the ploid level and it will work with a hidden Markov model for any ploid level. It's like a general procedure that works for any possible case. Of course, you can use it for a diploid. If you use it for a diploid, you're going to have the same result you have using MapMaker or OneMap, our software, because they use hidden Markov models to build a linkage map. Okay, so final considerations. I think I'm just right on time. Right? Okay, so final considerations regarding all these things. What would be the next steps? We don't work only with sugarcane. We have collaborations with people with different polyploid species. For example, there is a group, Leticia, which she was a postdoc in my lab. Now she's PNPD CAPES in my lab. I don't know how to say in English, in genetics department. She's there as a PNPD cop, is working in our department. She's working with Panico Massimo in a collaboration with Embrapa and people from the University of Campinas, Professor Annette, that is a very important collaborator of my group. We also have data from sugarcane. And also, of course, I am in touch with Marcelo, that is working with Shaobang Zeng with sweet potato. Guilherme Pereira, that is also over there working with sweet potato. Rodrigo, Amadeu, and Felipe Ferrão, they are working with berries in Florida, with Patricio Munoz. They also have polyploids over there, and they are trying to do, you know, similar things like building maps and doing genomic selection or GWAS, but in a different scenario that are polyploids, autopolyploids. So we think that this one will help people work with this kind of species. Once we have the map, we should think about QTL, we should think about the genomes. I should put the three dots here because it will open a number of opportunities once you are able to estimate the map, because you're going to understand a number of features about the genome of autopolyploid species. I think that's all. Thank you.
So thank you, Professor, for the great talk. So now we are open to questions. I think I will start. You are in Medverse, so I don't have too many questions. But this...
We didn't discuss this previously.
Yeah, we yeah, you showed three methods, no? The supermassa and updog and for building genetic maps. The three of them are able to deal with different ploidies, like sugarcane.
Supermass, yes. Supermass is for any ploid level. Updog, yes. But updog doesn't estimate the ploid level. So you need to have some idea about the ploid level of the SNP you are doing. So you can, for example, run supermass in a previous round, estimate the ploid level, and then you can use updog for, you know, refining the analysis, because updog will be able to, you know, put more information, modeling more information that you have in your data. And the script, the Python script, is to, of course, including supermassa, so any ploid level, and the map, yes, any ploid level, any autopolyploid species.
Any more else?
Okay, Rodrigo. Gustavo.
Microphone is coming.
Professor Augusto, what's the principal limitations of this method for analyze allotetraploids?
Allotetraploids, I think they will behave like diploids on the segregation for most, the majority of the loci. For that loci, you can use everything you have for diploids. If you have a copy of a loci in the different genomes, you need to derive the distribution they're going to have. But this, I think this is quite possible. I didn't think about that. I don't have experience with allotetraploids, but I think you just need to say, for example, heterozygous loci here in this part of genome, and also on this one, and homozygous on this one, we're going to have expected segregation. I think that at least in theory, it should work. I'm not sure. I need to think in detail. I don't have experience on that. But in principle, you need to derive the distributions. The thing here is that to derive the distributions, because you use that one to look in your data if it will behave like you are expecting if you make a cross.
Nice presentation, thank you.
Thank you.
You didn't talk much about it, but you did allude to this VCF2SM project, which is something we've been also trying to develop a similar functionality because it clearly is a gap in what's available.
Okay.
One of our, what we see often in our data sets is that the, sometimes just looking at read counts, you would infer a certain genotype quality, a certain quality of your maximum a posteriori call, but if you use software such as GATK, for example, which uses the information from the map quality and the base quality data that you would propagate, you often will come up with a very different, a much lower genotype quality. So it seems like there's some information there which perhaps is useful. Any plans to try and include those other aspects of the overall pipeline into your genotype calling?
Gabriel should give more detail. Gabriel is sitting over there because he developed the script in pretty much everything. But of course, the idea is to put the information you have and somehow use that in the next steps of the pipeline. We are concerned it's not just a script to automatize your task, but to capture information that you can use in future steps. Can you say, want to say a few words, Gabriel?
So I think now that UpDog is available, I don't know if it's worthwhile to spend the time to include that into Supermassa. So perhaps an idea would be to do as Augusto said, because Supermassa allows you to choose the best ploidy. So perhaps we should think about doing an initial round with Supermassa, finding the best ploidy for each SNP. And then you can actually use GATK or FreeBase or any fixed ploidy software that handles all the sequence quality and all this accessory information to do a better quality assessment of each genotype. Or UpDog handles sequencing errors. I don't think it handles something like read position or adjacent nucleotides or anything like this. So my guess is that using UpDog or GATK or perhaps modifying UpDog to also include this information would be better than trying to insert everything back into Supermassa. So Supermassa may be a first screening for ploidy, and then use more refined tools for each individual quality. And then I think including quality in the linkage analysis would be the hardest part, right?
Yeah, right. So this is the method is ready to do that, to include errors in the genotyping calling, the SNP calling. To put this on the map as well, because the hidden Markov model allows you to model the error you have when you're making a call. So that would be cool, but not there yet. Another thing, Gabriel, just to mention is that if you have the technology from the machine, for if you use Tasso, for example, for some intermediate task, it's not ready for autopolyploids in most of the scenarios, because it's not ready for species when you have, for example, more depth on the read, more copies of the read because you're trying to estimate the ploidy level. So there are fine tuning pretty much everywhere to be done. Okay. More questions?
More questions?
Could be in Portuguese, no problem.
It's okay. I would like to thank you, and okay. We have a gift for you too.
I like gifts.